Hello everyone, welcome back to Ring of Fates. In the last one, we took down the Valley of Heroes, and today we're moving on to Old Town. Before we do this though, I recommend you stock up on Fire, Blizzard, and Electric Magicites, some healing items if you're a little bit worried about the dangers and perils of crossing through the urban surroundings. Stuff to keep in mind, but otherwise we should be just fine, so let's head on over and go explore the ruins of a destroyed city, probably with a bunch of skeletons and monsters there. That's something you would expect. Alright, let's head on over here, and you'll notice this area is a very, very green area. Covered in moss, very old. Generally, the monsters you see around here won't be too big of a problem, since you'll encounter most of them already. And generally, the difficulty in this area stems from not getting lost and running out of supplies rather than dealing with enemies, so it's a little bit like the opposite of Mount Vow, where you will have lots and lots of perilous dangers ahead of you. But rather more that you'll just need lots of supplies to prepare for this. And you'll notice the game gives you quite a few, but sometimes you'll lack on Blizzard Magicites, and if you're inexperienced with this area, sometimes you may accidentally run out of Fire Magicites. Lightning Magicites are excellent for when we're dealing with a boss, so that's something to keep in mind. The trifecta of Attack Magicites are very important in Old Town, so something to keep in mind. Now, instead of fighting these monsters, you're gonna want to turn down to the bottom right away. And this will lead us to the area where we can get our permanent upgrades. Now, be careful when you're firing off your bow as a Selkie. Try to face the opposite direction, the direction where you came from, when you're firing the bow, just so you don't accidentally break a barrel that's up ahead. And if you do break it, you'll have to leave and re-enter the area in order to respawn it. But you're going to need that barrel in order to spawn and hop into the little dungeon city in here. You can't jump over the walls because there's invisible walls around them. So that's something to keep in mind. So what I want to do is clear all the monsters around here first, just for the sake of EXP. And after that, then we'll be able to grab the barrel and head on into the area. Now, even if you're very confident with how good you are with spellcasting, I highly encourage you stock up on those Fire and Blizzard Magicites. Because, well, timing is a little annoying sometimes, so it's always good to have a little extra hanging around for you. Now let's grab these gill. And we'll be able to access this area again in the future, so if you're not feeling up to it, or if you don't have the supplies but you can't afford them, you can check back in later, and I'll mention this later on in the video. But otherwise, we don't have to worry too much about that since we stocked up prior, and we can get access to this area right away. So let's go! Now, we're essentially trying to clear out floor after floor of enemies in this little castle area, as well as cast some Magicites in order to break the barriers that are all around here. And that way we'll be able to get at our upgrades. Old Town is somewhat popular for people who are looking to fill up all their Magicite pockets, since you'll be able to get one of each from this area. However, it's a little bit time consuming, so some people might opt to other areas. I wouldn't blame them. But it's pretty efficient since you're able to guarantee yourself at least one raised pocket each time. These lizard men are very annoying, so as a Selkie, your charge attacks are pretty effective actually. Especially your tribal ability, which will allow you to do a lot of damage. If you're a melee class, you won't have to worry about that. Just shoot them from their backs and you should be just fine. Alright, let's keep on going through. Now up ahead, you notice there are two Magicite switches lined up parallel to each other. And what you need to do is activate both of them at once. If you don't, well, they'll respawn, and that means you won't be able to get through. This is where stocking up on the Magicites comes in handy, because even if you're very good at timing, sometimes you mess something up, and you don't want to have a very, very strict limit on yourself. So let's sit here quietly and wait for the sound. Alright, there we go. So the first seal is broken. And I believe we have two or three more. I think two, but we'll find out sooner or later. There's one more seal, and that will require our Blizzard Magicite. It's a little annoying because sometimes you aren't able to listen to the cues with enemies around, so make sure to clear that out first, especially since they can interrupt your spells. Another annoying thing is that sometimes the camera doesn't really work in your favor, so you can't see when it's activated, and you'll have to rely on sound. So, two iffy moments around here, otherwise we shouldn't worry too much about this. Fighting in enemies are a little annoying in tight spaces, but this shouldn't be too big of a problem for melee characters, and if you're not a melee character, like this lovely Selkie here, well, you might want to clear out everyone but the lizard first, The lizard being annoying and won't really cause too much of a trouble, considering it doesn't have a melee attack. So there we go, that's one down. I might want to try my hand at tribal abilities, so let's do that. There we go, and we unlock ourselves the charge guard ability. So, by charging up your attack and then holding the R button, you're able to cast a shield to protect yourself from enemy attacks. So pretty much what the enemies have been doing to you at this point. We're gonna go with Blizzard first, since we're nearly out of those, and hopefully the camera works in my favor. Come on. Alright, not fast enough. Let's try this again. As you can see, it's very annoying, and sometimes very, man, just sight-consuming. Darn it! Okay, well, let's keep trying. There's a reason why I stock up on these things, and it's apparently because I'm not good. I believe other classes are able to lock two rings at once, which makes this a lot easier for them, but Selkies don't have that ability. Anyways, here's our first set of pockets to grab. If we move over to the right side, we have a few more enemies to deal with, and they are definitely well worth your efforts, considering... you worked so hard in order to get up here already. You might as well kill two more enemies in order to get all the spoils around here. So, there we go. And this should unlock a new chest for us on the other tile area, I suppose. Let's break open this chest, then we'll be able to get a glimpse at three new Magicite pockets. Clear, Raise, and Cure. So that's our six Magicite pockets. Let's get out of here and go back to the original room we were supposed to clear out. Alright, so real good time to stock up on Blizzard Magicites out here. A great way to grab a few of those. Fire Magicites are pretty much littered all around the area in Old Town, so it's not necessarily required to buy Magicites, but it's a lot more time saving, and considering how long these videos can get, I'd rather just purchase things since I only have to fund one character. And also, since I'm doing two runs of each area, it's not too much of a worry for me since I'll get a surplus of materials and I don't really have to worry about money or boss items. As well as EXP, because it's always good to get a little bit of extra boss EXP in the gutter. But let's clear out this area. So far so good. We have a few more Magicite switches to put on. This time we have a blue stand there. Something you can access right away if you want, but not something that we really need to concern ourselves about just yet. Let's go open these barrels up, and I think there's materials in them. Or not. Either way, it's a good time to get some ether and a potion, which I believe I need to show on screen this time around, so if that's the case, well, it's on screen right now. Isn't that lovely? There we go. Broke open the switch, and we'll be able to access the door in order to move on ahead, so let's do just that. And we'll be able to move up here where the checkpoint box originally was. Great. Alright, so let's do a careful sweep of this area since we haven't killed the monsters up here yet. Some monsters are activated by breaking open chests, and I'm sure you already knew that from past videos here and there. There we go, that's one down. This guy's on my head, get off it. I don't even understand how you didn't take damage from that. There's a reason why I'm wearing a little spike on my helmet. Jeez, it's not for decoration, you know? Alright. So far so good, nothing too much to worry about. Like I said, the monsters around here aren't too hard to deal with. The lizards are a little bit tedious, yes, but even the boss in this area should be just fine for us to deal with. So, with that, we'll be able to access the gate we wanted to, once we defeat more enemies, of course, because there's a few more up ahead. They're a little annoying, fire casting is very annoying, and having a skeleton around is no fun either, but they shouldn't cause too much of a trouble either. Okay, come on. Hey! Is it dead yet? No, it isn't. Well, technically it was always dead. Haha, undead jokes. Alright, let's activate this candle and this will pop open a gate. There we go. And let's head on through. Awesome. Now, you only need to worry about a few enemies on this map in order to move on through, so that's something I'll cover later on when we do our little second run through of the area. But in the meantime, the basic gimmick of this area is to activate a switch that will move the corresponding color of tiles up or down. So you'll notice by flipping the switch red, there's now a platform up here. So let's clear out these enemies while we still can. So that should be two goblins and a skeleton. There we go. Ah, alright. Let's work on one goblin at a time. These guys can get very annoying. If you're burnt, you might as well just stand in their spell. It doesn't really matter too much. They don't cause too much damage as long as you stay far away from the skeleton, which can be quite annoying. But otherwise, goblins are pretty run-of-the-mill. So there we go. We got these guys down. If we move up ahead a little bit more, there's a chest for us. Let's break that open. Great. Now, I could drop down from here and move on ahead, but instead, we're going to go our ways around since this is what this run-through of the area is meant to be. Up ahead, we should see a flan goop, and if you don't have any magicites on you, just use your charge attack or your tribal abilities, because otherwise, it's a little annoying to do damage. You also have some barrels here if you aren't prepared whatsoever, but I don't think we're going to need those. I'll carry one with me, though, just for good measure, a nice souvenir. There we go. And you basically have to flip your switch all the way around this area. A little bit annoying. A little tedious. Very annoying to drop and fall into the water down below, of course. But it's not too hard. Just be glad they are very easy jumps to deal with. Nothing to worry about whatsoever. The claustrophobic space might be a little bit annoying for Selkies. But since we have a stomping ability, it shouldn't affect us too badly. There we go. Can I get that ether? There we go. That's what I wanted. Alright, let's move on through ahead. Not too much left. We're near the home stretch. Technically, we didn't have to do any of this, but regardless, it's worth showing off and getting a bunch of EXP because that's very important in this luck game. I want to stay above leveled, especially since this game has the hard and harder difficulties available and whatnot. Stuff you just generally don't want to deal with. So there we go. Got another flying goop down. And since we got rid of almost all the enemies, we still have to clear out this area. We'll be able to unlock a key for this area. Alright. I think I'll deal with the goblin first, since he poses the biggest threat to me. Next, I will deal with the skeleton, since the moo is just annoying being a flat enemy. There we go. Now we can just deal with you, who rarely attacks. Even the skeleton alive can be annoying because you might accidentally pick up items that are laying on the field. But there we go, we can now get at a key. Normally you have to circle all the way around, but thankfully we have a double jump, and since we've cleared out this entire area, I won't bother doing another hike around the area. There we go. I'm gonna cast two clear magicites real quick to get our SP back. There we go. And this will unlock us to the area where we can take a checkpoint. Now, hitting flying goops normally can yield little to no damage, as you can tell, so charge attacks are very, very valuable on a Selkie. And it's essentially the best way to do lots and lots of damage the moment you enter a fight. A lot of our abilities and upgrades we get later on as we progress in levels all benefit charge attacks. And this gives us a huge advantage compared to Clavats, where their second form of their charge attack is pretty useless because of how slow it is. The Lotis can't really do too much with that because it's more like a pot thing. And I don't think the Yukes have very much fun with it either, since they have to, you know, drop a Magicite, switch into the tribal abilities and draw around, which might not always be the fastest option. Anyways, we're gonna go over here, which is the boss area, just to grab this barrel. But otherwise, let's circle back around and move into the little area here that is available for us, since we still need to get the boss key. So let's go. We're gonna move down the staircase first. A few more of these lizard men. Remember, keep your distance unless you're a melee character. Otherwise, pray. There we go. Very annoying, as you can tell with the block thing. It has a very easy way of shutting down Clavats and stuff. If you're mindlessly just mashing your attack button, sometimes you're just gonna get stuck in a guard chain and eventually die because of it. Especially combined with other enemies, which makes this a very, very dangerous combination. Alright. Once again, not too tough of an area. Try not to fall into the emptiness there, since that leads you into a different map, I believe. We'll check out this map soon, but I want to clear all the enemies up on this upper level first. There we go. If I stop talking roundly, it's because I'm concentrating, trying my hardest not to get hit by an enemy. Getting hit by your enemy has a tendency of just destroying your entire train and your thought process. I don't know why I said train. As you can tell, my thought process has already been destroyed, but regardless, we're great. We're doing great. We can climb up here if you want, and that's through this little ceiling bit here. And this will get us at a chest, I believe. There we go. Nothing we really need. I'll take the clear magicite, since I could always use some more with how much I'll be using charge attacks nowadays. Over here, we should deal with one more enemy. There we go. This red magicite table, whatever you want to call it, is replaced with a hard switch for Clavats. Probably something else for other races. But for us, we get a little magicite table. Let's drop this thing here, and this will open up the door up above. Not the platform, unfortunately. If you want to get at the platform, you'll unfortunately have to go all the way around and jump into that well that you can see just off in the corner over there. So that's what we're trying to work at, if our character can aim and actually hit the skeleton. Come on, Sokia, you can do better than that. There we go. Alright, a few more things around here. I think a moo, maybe a goblin. Not too sure. Nothing secretive around here. We've already unlocked the permanent upgrades here, so I don't think there's any more. If there are, you can correct me, but I don't think there are any. There we go. Alright, shall we read the sign? Yeah, let's. You can go down the well, Coupeau. Okay. Well, there's already a portal there, so it's pretty easy to tell, thanks to the minimap. Anyways, going down here, this might be the most annoying spot, considering it's primarily designed for Lotis. Try not to break this barrel yet, since we're gonna need this thing. So, obviously, don't face the barrel when you're attacking things, just so you don't accidentally risk breaking it. I might want to use a little bit of my tribal ability here, but it's pretty hard to set this up right now. Let's focus on using our charge attacks if we can. I want to take care of the goblins first, since hucking rocks around is very annoying. There we go, that's one down. Using your charge ability is pretty good as well, since you don't really run the risk of hitting anything you didn't intend to hit. Sometimes you miss, as you can see with that one attack that just flew into the ground. But by killing all the enemies, we'll unlock a platform that would take us up to where that door that we had just unlocked was. Now, this barrow, you want to push it near the corner, jump on top of it, and then double jump to that area right ahead of you. There we go. And then we'll be able to get at this chest here, which contains a little bit of extra money, and we can ride the platform back. How you get at this? You need a lovely low teapot here, which we do not have, and you notice that maps around here will occasionally have these areas which are demonstratively meant for a single class, yet they don't really account for this in multiplay. Stuff that's a little bit annoying. You'll encounter one of the silky versions of this in the future, which is stuck over in Abyss's forest. So we'll be able to see that in a video or two. Otherwise, let's take a quick dip and then hop back on through, and we'll be able to get back to where we were going. Come on, there we go. Alright, let's ride this on up, and there we go. We are taken to the door. We can activate this if you want as a checkpoint. No reason to, but it's there for you. Now, before we go through, you notice that there was a doorway down here already. You don't really want to access this area first, despite it not making very much sense, and you'll see why, since it'll force you to do a double loop back. So instead, we're going to take the highway up, which is why I never bothered acknowledging the door below. And I should mention, jumping off this will also yield an invisible wall, which you can't get back up from. Believe me, I tried. So that's the reason why we're going to focus on this upper area first. And after we're done clearing up the upper area, we'll head back down to the lower one. Otherwise, all you need to remember is to avoid falling off walls, because some of them are pretty important and won't let you back up. Alright, let's focus on some lizards here. More run-of-the-mill monsters, there's not too much to say. I don't know what kind of town this is, considering there's just checkered flooring everywhere on top of roofs and whatnot. Whoever designed these houses and stuff, I can see why the city was abandoned. Not exactly good for the decor. Now, since we still have some ethers, I'm gonna use my charge ability in order to recover SP instead. My clear magicite combo magic something. Keep combining words, you'll get something correct eventually. That's what I say. And that's why I'm terrible at speaking. Yeah! Okay. Not too much else to worry about. This is where your fire magic lights come in hand, so I hope you have a few to spare. Otherwise, not too much to worry about for this area, just a giant ring of enemies over and over. A generic floor pattern, if you will, just like those checkered roofs. Yeah. Alright. So far, so good. I prefer charge attacks to deal with these guys rather than magicite since I don't like switching around with a mouse. Awesome. So far, so good. Nothing else to really say about this area. It's a neat looking area, I will say this. Old Town, I'm curious what you would look like if you were still New Town. Probably filled with people that I can talk to, people that I can analyze. Talk to every single NPC for every little bit of dialogue. A little bit of the story for Ring of Fates, I believe, is that Rebena Te Ra is the last city around town that's still habitable after a while. A poisonous miasma goes through the entire area, and we get to visit a bonus stage which shows us that way future near the end of the series, so don't count your ducks yet, because that is still a long way to be seen. Of course, right now I'm just trying to make commentary, obviously, because there's nothing really else to say. Neat, that's a nice looking bridge. Is that good enough for you people? Clearly not. Alright. Okay, let's keep on moving on. And I think we're going to encounter a few candles here. Yes, we are. And what you need to do is light three of them, all three at once. Well, not at once, but you need to light all three in order to activate a platform. Be careful, these candles can extinguish after a certain amount of time, so do it quickly. Don't dilly-dally. Make sure you have three available right away so you can activate all three candles at once, or in rather quick succession, just in case if one of them blows out or something. Great. Now that we've gotten our electric magicite, we can now activate the barrier into the low area. If you went through the low area, congratulations, you have to go all the way around and back through the upper area now if you want to advance through the game. That is why I will save that for after we're done clearing out all these enemies. And I think that's pretty much good. Let's go check out the lower area before we deal with those locked doors that are coming up ahead. So, it's a little bit weird in order to move this from the end of the area back to the start of it. It's a little weird in that some of the platforms weren't really meant for that. But this area on its own is sort of stupid. You force a player to go all the way through around here, yet going back is a little annoying, as you can tell. Instead, you have to jump over, and by killing the skeleton, you'll notice he yields the one fire magicite that you needed. Come on, die already so I can have it. Fine, throw you at a wall. You're gonna dead. Yeah, get smashed. You see? There you go. Let's activate the candle. We might as well. There we are, and the platform has spawned in. You can check out this lower area if you want a little bit of extra EXP or a few items, but otherwise it's not really necessary. It's the same tedious area that's in the upper area, just that you don't get to advance by taking the lower path first. So remember, kids, the moral of this story is to take the upper path and also be a bow-wielding maniac that destroys lizards and angry brown balls of muscle. Come on. Alright, that's one. Can I get a two? Yes, I can. There we go. Alright. One more chest to clean out, but I'm not too sure if there's anything more up here. I don't think so. There we go. Alright, so let's move on back and move towards what should be progress. Alright. Come on, where are we? There we go. Let's go ride up. Use those platforms to our advantage. You can actually double jump over here. Now, if you don't really need any more monsters and you have sufficient yellow and red magicites, you can ignore this chest and open up the doors and move on with your daily life. But by cracking it open, you spawn in two enemies, but you'll be able to get all the resources you need in order to activate both doors. Now, I hope that yellow barrier is familiar towards you, because that's our second path to the permanent upgrades if you weren't able to carry around the resources you need. Hopefully you have them now, because you can't really access this area again without backtracking. Something to keep in mind. There we go. And let's clear out the lizard. We won't hop back in order to check out the permanent upgrades area since we've just done that. But that's something to keep in mind if you're ever interested in a free pocket of all. With that, let's move on to the next area. There we go. We have a few moves here and they're a little bit annoying. I recommend taking care of them first since they can make you trip and fall into boiling yellow water. Let's hop over this platform first in order to grab the key and then put it on the platform. I think the moves here respawn forever. I'm not sure. I always seem to encounter a surplus of them for some reason, so that's something to consider for yourself. And there's a Moogle back here, so this is where you get your stamp. But we already have the stamp, so no worries. And we don't really want the prize, so goodbye. There we go. Alright, let's activate the switch and head on through. I suppose that the moos are infinitely spawning in order to make sure no one can end up getting trapped here. I don't really see the problem since there's a back way out. But with that, we're finally going to be able to head on and fight the boss. So I hope you're ready, and I hope you kept all your fundamentals because this boss fight is going to be a piece of cake. Alright, so usually the behemoth will want to start his attack with a lightning strike, a little laser bolt. Nothing to worry about, you'll notice that the crystal is underneath his belly, and we're going to lure him out first before we actually do the exploit, but he'll stand up occasionally. You want to try to hit his crystal when you can, and try not to get hit yourself. And if you manage to hit his crystal, he'll turn back on his belly, allowing you to hit him a bunch of times. This is terribly annoying for a Selkie, so instead we can actually cast lightning magicites on the back, on the belly of them, and this will turn him around if we don't get stunned and if we actually hit the crystal. Of course, I'm running into a lot of spell attacks right now, so this isn't going the best for me. But I think we'll be able to hit this one. There we go. And he'll turn around completely for you. And since the lightning magicite is really effective, we don't actually have to wait for the magic resist to clear out. Instead, we can immediately move into another one, albeit it doesn't always work. If you don't have lightning magicites, you can use blizzard magicites, but you run the risk of that anti-magic buff they have afterwards, as well as the fact that sometimes it just doesn't work out. I prefer electric or thunder magicites because they're a little bit faster than blizzard ones, but I think blizzard ones are the best safe bet. And we'll switch on over to this in order to show you guys, just to see if I can prove my point or not, or if my memory is hazy. Since you have to wait for them, sometimes they don't turn around like that. You know what, let's try using our blizzard magicite so we can actually get him to turn upside down. I don't think fire magicites work for this guy, unfortunately, so that's something to keep in consideration. There we go, we hit the crystal, so now we can hop back on here, but the whole freezing delay is just a little too long in my opinion, so I prefer to stick to lightning magicites. And that's really important since if the fight gets prolonged as a Selkie, you're just running the risk of dying much easier. He has a wide array of attacks, and his attacks are very likely to kill Selkies. They do a lot of damage, they stun Selkies. Some of them can be chained together despite the fact that he's the only monster on the field. Stuff like that, so trying to get as much damage out on him as fast as possible is definitely a viable strategy. We didn't stun him with that attack because we hit him before he was doing his little thingy, but either or, he still fell on his belly because we did 40 damage, which was our lovely crystal hit attack. There we go, another hit. I reckon this would turn him upside down. What you want to do is jump whenever he does a little stomping attack if you miss, or just run far, far away from the area of attack. Attack of area. What's an AoE? Area of effect. There we go. I forgot that acronym. Is that what an acronym's called? I forget it all. Oh, darn it. He resisted. All right. Otherwise, we have two Thunder Magicites. Not too much to worry about. We're pretty much done with this area. So we can actually turn him up. There we go. Pretty piece of cake. Very easy once you get used to it. The lightning magicites makes him a breeze of a boss fight, so nothing to really worry about. Just because it flinches doesn't mean it'll always turn upside down, so that's something to keep in mind. And if you're not very trustworthy of yourself and you're worried about high damage, be sure to stock up on your healing items. And with that, come on! No! Don't you dare! Come on! There we go. With that, we managed to take down the behemoth. Yeah! Alright, let's grab all these items here. Alright. And what I think I want to do first is head back to Rebena Te Ra, buy permanent upgrades, and then head back out here to do our little quick run there. We might as well also grab our lightning magicites, but we won't be talking to NPCs just yet. So let's go grab some lightning magicites so we can go through the boss fight as fast as possible without wasting your time going through the area and fighting the boss normally, which is terribly exhausting. Hello, Mugo. Sell me your wares. What do we have? 2 fire pockets, I would take that. And a blizzard pocket, not too bad. Usually you'll max out the pockets on the top first, so your fire and blizzard and lightning magicite pockets usually get maxed out first, followed by your potion pockets, and usually your cure and clear afterwards. I find that the raised pockets are probably the hardest to max out. At any rate, let's move into our speedrun area right now. You'll want to have your fire magicite selected right away, because thanks to our cunning and beautiful abilities, we're able to jump and double jump up here immediately, unlocking the door and completely voiding what was probably the first 15 minutes of this video. Not to mention, we only have to destroy, I believe, the 2 moves here. So let's do that. Come on, there we go. I believe we have to destroy the 2 goblins plus skeleton up here. We're not gonna activate the skeleton just yet, since I don't want too many enemies fighting me at once. So this might take a little bit of time to deal with, since that's simply just navigating, attacking, and dodging in the battlefield. But otherwise, not too much to worry about. Now let's deal with our skeleton. I'm gonna prepare a charge attack for him right away. Leaving with a little bit of stutter, and it looks like the skeleton won't be able to get an attack off. There we go. Let's move on through and head to the last part of this area where we have to deal with a few enemies on and on a boat. Take care of the moo. Take care of the skeleton. And then the goblin. Ah, we're getting hit by ranged attacks. This is why I usually leave the skeleton for last. But it's okay, I'm just rushing through. I'll hit any target that they'll let me hit. So far so good, there we go. And this should activate the key for us. There we are. So we don't have to go all the way around, but that's something you can do on your own time if you ever wish to. I just like going through these areas as quick as possible. Yeah, let's go. Now with that, we're able to move on ahead and go after our lovely permanent item thingy-ma-bob. Ugh, not permanent item, sorry. Let's move on ahead and skip through all those enemies and shenanigans below. We won't have to worry about the well since we can just double jump over here with our amazing double jump ability, which saves us so much time as speedrunners and whatnot. Just open up the gate and head on through. There we go. We still have quite a few fire magicites, so we won't have to worry too much about that. But if you don't, no fear. Because once we get to the Kando area, come on. I hinted previously that we don't actually need to activate the candles. No, we can just double jump right on over this, which is great. And once again, we don't have to fight the monsters here since, come on, they're only for the chest. So we can move straight on through. Let's grab our key first. There we are. Put it down. And then activate the magicite little platform. There we go. If you really want, you can toss it onto the wall, just carry it on your head and double jump across. Something that I'm going to do right here, which I can simplify much easier. But you can do that on the other area as well. I prefer not to, since there's water everywhere, and if you miss, you'll have to fetch your key again because it'll, you know, despawn back to where it originally meant to be. So now we're back to fighting the behemoth. Should be easier the second time around. Hopefully I don't get hit too many times. But speedrun, pretty easy, pretty good. Alright. Got a little bit of damage dealt on him. We're gonna get hit by a laser beam. Or not. Okay. I'm okay with that, actually. Lucky dodge, I suppose. Maybe we're just like right beside it. Shot right past her shoulder. I'm not sure. Maybe it's because my name is Raylazor or it decided to spare me. Who knows? Magic works in magical ways. There we go. You can actually stand right on top of him and you won't get knocked off. Instead, he'll turn right around to the perfect area you'll want in order to hit his crystal, something to keep in mind. Just a great time all around, behemoth, as you can tell. More like a little kitty cat with its claws, like, denailed. Of course, denailing your cats are kind of sad because you're essentially, like, ripping off their fingers, in a way. Why am I talking about cats again? This thing doesn't look like a cat. Well, it looks like a cat to me because I don't like cats. I'm a dog person. Yeah! Alright. Almost done. Grab our spoils. Head back to town. talk to a few NPCs, do a quest, and then end the episode and call it a day. Oh, and then spend the next 5 hours editing it and then forgetting something important, which makes yourself upset. Makes myself upset, actually. Ah, okay. It's so annoying dealing with random drops because you don't know what equipment would drop in your playthrough or not, and then if you like it's necessary to cover something when you don't really need to. Anyways, we're done with our run through of Old Town second time around. Let's go around town and talk to some people around. Have I said around enough? I think not. Alright, so we have two little fellows here. Oh dang, that was close! I had no idea monsters be popping up all over the place in Old Town.
That was absolutely the best game of hide and seek ever!
If Sis found out, we'd have way more to worry about than monsters, huh?
Yes, but we can't stop playing just cause we're scared of her. Next up, a vicious forest.
I don't see Sis around. I wonder where she went.
Who cares? Now's our chance.
So we have two troublemakers over in like the east side of town, I guess. There we go. And I think that's it for NPCs actually. So our technical two NPCs, which are pretty much just one sharing the same dialogue. But I don't think there's really anything else to be said around here, so let's go to town, buy a few things, stuff like that. Alright, let's go to our custom crafts workshop and we'll see what we can get at. So we can make a fledgling's weapon, which I don't want. We can make an iron weapon, which I need tree branches for. So let's see if we can buy one of those tree branches. No, we can't. This is absolutely amazing. I'm set back by a weapon. I'll probably do this off screen, let's be honest. Because I like staying up to date with my weapons just so I don't have to worry about damage. So we want one leather and one silk and three silk and one leather. We do not have enough moofer for that. Can we buy moofer? I hate how these stores are like way out of stock for most things. Okay, there's one moofer here. This is cutting it close. It looks like I have to do another run of this area. Okay, forget this. We're going on a special journey, kids. We're going back to the Valley of Heroes. But this time, it's going to be a little bit quicker since I found a little thing. I noticed a little discrepancy when I was doing this. As like, I don't know, for funsies. I like running through the areas and looking for things I can do to make things a little bit faster. So what we're going to do is try to fight the scorpion boss as fast as possible and see if maybe he'll be here to drop us with like an extra piece of silk or two. Maybe we should kill these moves. I think they only give you gold though, so not really worth it since we don't really need that. Ooh, is that fur? Okay, we got lucky. We got an extra piece of fur. I'm okay with that. There we go. Not exactly the speediest of speedy runs, but what I learned is that you can actually just double jump over this instead of pushing the block. Saves you a lot of time because of how slow the animation is. So let's get grinded up by a rock and move straight on ahead. Maybe we'll kill this moo too. Please give me fur. And maybe a tree branch or two. I could deal with those too. Alright, we got a nose. That is not what I wanted, but okay. Alright, let's move on ahead. Nothing too much to worry about. There we go. Let's ignore all these guys. We don't need to talk to you, plebs. We've done this before. You can also push this from up here, but it doesn't really matter since there's a little indent there that will force you to push it regardless. So it's better just to push it since the beginning, so there's less to worry about. Hopefully the three skeletons we kill up ahead will drop us a tree branch or something. I really want to get out an iron weapon. I'm not too concerned about the attributes on it since, you know, beggars can't be choosers. But I still would love a tree branch if you guys could oblige, you know? Maybe one stuck in your rib cage or something? No, please? Just one? I will take just one. Any, please. Alright, well, let's have the key drop on us. There we go. And that's a scroll, so I don't need that. Alright, chuck this here and let's go fight the boss. Hello, scorpion boss. I'm here for your free stuff, so just give me that. Yeah, just do your laser attack so I can try to angle myself onto your little stabby joint. What do you call those? Stingers? Yeah, stingers, I guess. Scorpion tail? That's probably the more obvious answer. But yeah, I just really wanted to show off that little tiny bit about Valley of Heroes, and as well hopefully get a tree branch because I really want one. But otherwise, not too much to worry about. This area gets easier and easier to deal with every day. I think I know this area sort of really well because of how many times I've played it in story mode. I always feel like playing story mode again at some point, and then I end up saying, this is boring. And then I hop right into multiplayer where I don't have to worry about the silly old story. Alright, let's hop on this guy. Let's work on him. So far, so good. Should be down now, actually. There we go. Give me a tree branch, Scorpion. You can actually slightly push the boss, I think. Some stuff to keep in mind. We got an oak branch. I think that's what I wanted. I'm not sure. I hope it is. Anyways, let's go back to town. Buy more permanent upgrades because I love hoarding permanent upgrades. And then finally go shopping. So this video, an extra little bit longer since we're going back and around to areas we've already visited before, including the Mogmart, where we're going to be able to get 4 extra points of health. I'm okay with that. Sokis can use all the health they can get. All the defense too, if you want. Because of how squishy we are. Kind of annoying. Alright. Let's buy all of the stuff out. Cure pockets, widely appreciated because I have a tendency of getting myself killed a lot. I do a lot of suicidal things, trying to find sneaky areas to do things. There we go. Alright. Now then, let's get back to our business. Hopefully we'll be able to get an iron weapon now. Please. No! Tree branches! They're actual tree branches. Okay, sell me tree branches, please. I beg of you. Yes! 4 tree branches! Are you kidding me? Ah! There's so many tree branches! I'm so happy! Alright, let's buy iron as well in case we want to get an iron weapon. Oh no, I felt like bursting out in celebration, so don't mind me. I'm an odd fellow. I'm sitting here talking to myself for like an hour straight, recording a video game. What did you expect? We already have 4 of these scrolls, so we don't have to worry about that. 5 of those scrolls, jeez, alright. 3 of these. Ah, that's 2 silk, so I don't think we'll really be doing too much with that. Alright, let's go get the items we wanted to. So hopefully I can get a nice attack plus bow. Yes, I am! Woo, okay, good. Good purpose. Alright. Now then, red headwear. We need 1 leather, 1 silk, and 2 silk. So we need 3 silk and 1 leather. Alright, so we can probably get that. There we go, that's 1. 2 more, come on. Yeah, making all these items, how exciting. Alright, that's 3. I could try to go for a better hat since I think I have the resources for it. So let's make another piece of leather and another piece of silk so we can get at 2 hats and a torso piece, I believe. There we go. Alright. I really prefer the red set of these not hot clothings and stuff because they provide you with attack plus. So let's put that on and then go for the hat as well, which we can make 2 of. Yes, we can. So maybe we'll be able to get a nice one. Looks like we're going to get SP boost right away. Let's see if we can get something better. I'm more of a fan of defense if we can get at that. We're going to get anti-burn boost. I don't really need to worry about getting burnt since Selkies are naturally pretty resistant to that stuff, I believe. But otherwise, I don't think there's really much else for us to make. So let's call that a day. As you can see, we already have a +1 on fire resistance and a -1 on frost. So you can tell that Mount Vow will be a very annoying place for us Selkies. Let's stand here and do a nice little showcase of our sexy bod, our sexy polygonic bod. Yeah, don't you love that duplicated arm that is the exact same as the other arm? Oh yes, that skirt that looks like it was made of like a piece of aluminum foil. Beautiful. Okay, let's go do a quest. Enough faffing around. Jeez, alrighty. Hello, King Koka, I'm here for a quest. Yes, the city remains deserted. I am here to do white cats, black cats, 1. Press Y to grab white cat and black cat before they scurry away. Something, something, something. Carry cats around, they're annoying. I'm glad you decided to take on this quest. Allow me to fill you in on some of the details. We've had many cats living with us here at the castle. That is, until one day they all unexpectedly left. Yay, I can't read. Members of the castle staff have tried to catch them, but the feisty felines are simply too elusive. Ever since then, I can't eat and I am completely worn out. At the end of my rope, I hit upon the idea to find someone to bring back the cats as part of a quest. There is a catch, of course. Oh, of sorts. Yeah, Koka with the pun. You have to keep the white cats separate from the black ones. Whenever they are together, they wind up in a furry brawl. Social commentary with Rebena Te Ra's leader, King Koka. Yeah. I know it won't be easy rounding up so many of them, but please bring our cute and cuddly kitties home. So as you can suggest, the cats, being the terrible people they are, decided to run off. So now we have to capture and enslave them for delicious cuddles. So basically, they're gonna like run in a direction, and after a while, if you carry them for too long, they'll jump off your heads and like fly off. But you have to capture them all. That's pretty much the gist of it. Sometimes there's monsters guarding them and stuff. Just a bunch of annoying furballs, basically. So let's go get them. Something I like to do is throw them occasionally on the ground halfway through, carrying them just so they don't launch off of me. You can try to angle them so you can get the proper shot in there, because they have a tendency of just flying off to the most mundane and strange areas after they jump off. They can fly through the other side of the map, I would reckon. They have pretty strong legs. As you can see, they can refuse to get in the stupid point, so that's how you waste most of your time. They also make meowing noises, which I'm sure they'll trigger eventually, but there's apparently no meowing noises just yet. Two cats here, we'll grab the white one and then scare the black one on. Come on, okay, whatever, just stay there. There you go, he jumped off. Where are you, little rascal? Eh. Very annoying with platforms that are hanging from above, so you can't really see where they're supposed to go. Alright, let's throw this guy so I can predict where it's gonna end up. And then spend the next 3 minutes trying to get it inside the stupid cage. That's the most annoying part of this. You will literally lose and fail this mission because of that. Alright, where are you, yellow black cat? Back here? Where did it run off to? When did this happen? Ah, there you are. Okay, get over here. I'm more surprised we're not losing a ton of health because of these cats. I reckon they would turn into like a scratchy monster and just smashing everything, knocking things over, stealing all of the monster's equipment and starting up a cat army or something. Ugh, don't like cats. Alright, come on. Eh. There we go. Alright, two more to deal with and then we can move on to the second stage. Oh, I saw a white one down there. Where are you, yellow? Where are you? There we go. Alright, we got him. I love how it's floating up there. Ah, where'd you go? Get back here. Okay. Launching off my head? Jeez. Maybe we should find a better way of holding onto them so they can't jump off of us. I'm just saying. There we go. Alright, last cat. Let's go take care of you. Come on. I'm worried about the second stage because there will be a way for us to waste 4 minutes, basically, just trying to get a cat into a cage. Maybe we'll waste that 4 minutes right now, actually. Who knows? There we go. Alright, did you hear that meow? Lovely. Stage complete. Let's move to stage two. I don't believe it's required to kill the monsters, but if you don't, they're kind of annoying because they block your way. Like that. Get out of here, skeleton. This time around, the pens are on separate sides of the map, so if you thought this area was easy, it's just gotten a little bit worse. These cats have very long ears for whatever reason. Hello, leave me alone, skeleton. I can't be bothered with you. I'll throw you in this pen if I have to, alright? I'm just saying. I'm glad the black cats are all nearby, so I can hopefully complete one pen first. Go away, skeleton. No, not you, cat, get over here. Ah, this is rage-inducing. I hope the skeleton hops into the pen and kills all the cats. That way I don't have to worry about them anymore. Oh my god, okay, now you've gone too far. Get out of here. Don't come back. Get in there. Oh my gosh, how did you even do that? Fucking, I am gonna fucking slam dunk you if I have to. I'll go John Cena on your ass. Come on. Ah, they're so annoying. Get in there. There we go. Oh, cats. I hate them. I hate them. I don't know why anyone could love a creature so unloyal. I don't care if dogs are bred to be loyal or not. It's a good thing. You reward good behavior. Get in there. There we go. Where are you? You're a white cat too. Get in here. You're going in. Chuck you in here. There we go. That's another one. Alright. Is this a white cat? Yes, it is. Alright. Get over here. So far, so good. Hopefully we don't screw this up with the 2 minutes we have. No promises. One of my test recordings, I actually failed this mission by like half a second because this cat kept flying on outwards to the point where I just turned off the game and decided, you know what, I'll just check out this area later. I can't be bothered anymore. Get over here. Okay. Tuck you in. There we go. Alright, just one black cat left. Just you, partner. Let's go. Don't feel like dealing with the monsters. They're pretty much a distraction thing since I assume you'd assume that cats will spawn because of the monsters. That's not the case. And with that, we completed the quest, and we unlocked White Cats, Black Cats 2, the second sequel to the most infuriating quest of them all. Or actually the first sequel. But regardless, I am glad to see you back alive. Your skills were most impressive. The people of this country are most grateful for your heroics of grabbing the pussy and throwing it into the cage. Please accept this small token of appreciation. As usual, it's first come, first serve. Go! Alright, let's grab some materials, maybe something cool, maybe a few tree branches. Oh, we got a pet type amethyst, that's pretty good. Alright, stop. Until good day, meet good day. Okay, yeah. He said something like that, right? I don't know the details, but I think that's pretty much it. We've talked to our NPC. Two and one, I guess. That's the combo we're going with. We've ran through the old town twice. Did a run through a Valley of Heroes once as well to get tree branches, I believe. And, well, we didn't actually get tree branches because of the Valley of Heroes, but regardless, we got a bunch of permanent upgrades. I think the Mogmart will give you some more permanent upgrades after completing a mission, and indeed they will. So it looks like I'm gonna run out of money this video. We might as well go to the store and sell some things as well, since I forgot to mention you can do that. Is that all? There we go. Alright, well, let's go to the weapon store and see what we've missed, in case we did miss anything. I know for a fact that we didn't buy blue clothes and stuff, but I think it only really unlocks anything you've crafted, so. As you can see, the red and blue hats aren't available here yet, and it's only the green set of clothes, so we can't get at those yet. Accessories, there's a life ring here, but the power ring gives us much more for what we want. So, let's just sell our old weapons. We have one wooden bow here, one short bow here, and two of the same SP boost bows. So, let's sell those, get ourselves a little bit of pocket change. We can sell the red hat and our bronze helm as well, since we've upgraded to a nice regular red hat. I don't know what to tell you. Sell our corselet and our travel clothes. And we pretty much just have what we're wearing. If I really need money, I can sell the boss items we get, so that's not too much of a problem. With that, I think we're pretty much done for with this episode of Ring of Fates. So, thank you for watching this lovely episode of Ring of Fates. In the next one, we're moving off to the cool, cool place of Mount Val, where we get to freeze our butts off and run through the same area 4 times. Because there's 2 bosses. I will see you then. Thank you.